Well, the basic idea is very simple. It's to try to anticipate every way that children could possibly fail, and also to anticipate every way that children could succeed, and to make sure that the school has carefully planned to eliminate the possibility of failure in each one of the areas where things might go wrong, and to maximize the possibility of success. That means improving teaching methods, improving classroom management methods, improving assessment, identifying children who are having difficulties and providing them with tutoring or other kinds of services right away, making sure that the family is supportive and that the children are in school every day. Logical things, no one would come up with a terribly different list. The difference is that we've spent a long time trying to work out exactly how to do each one of those things, and then to help whole schools make sure that all of these things are taking place for every child every year. They say it sounds complex, sounds like it has a lot of moving parts. They're usually very excited about it. They're positive about it, I think. But it sounds like something very difficult to them. Many people have an impression that the way to improve education is to do one big thing, you know, to change governance or to increase funding or to reduce class size or do one thing. But everyone who really gets engaged in education realizes that it's not one thing, that there are many things that have to go right, particularly with children who are at risk, that there are many things that you have to anticipate and make sure go in a good direction before you can really be confident that the outcomes will be much better. As we've been at this for 26 years, we are increasingly seeing people who write to us. They're in university now, and they're talking about how the experience being in a Success for All school was really a turning point for them and really quite important to them. Parents have told us many times, for example, parents who had an older child who was not in a Success for All school and had great difficulty with them, and then see their next child who is, and see the huge difference in what the children receive and in the success that they achieve. So certainly, the closer you get to people who actually receive the program, or to the teachers and the principals who are engaged with it, the more there is a clear recognition of how different this is from the ordinary experience, and a real appreciation for what we're trying to do. I think that it's been more a step-by-step progression than a eureka moment. Before we began Success for All, we had been working on cooperative learning and on other kinds of smaller scale interventions that were at the level of teachers rather than the level of schools. Really, Success for All itself was the eureka moment when we began to see what the possibilities were for working with whole schools. Working with individual teachers is a wonderful thing, but so often individual teachers don't have the power, they don't have the ability to work beyond their own classroom. When we began to work with whole schools, and then you had the whole school, all of the teachers working with the principal, working with the community, all on the same page trying to benefit a group of children, that was where there was huge gain, really quite a different kind of reform than the teacher-by-teacher kind of reform that we had been doing. I definitely understood the teachers' reluctance. I mean, we're asking teachers to do an enormous amount. There's change in just about everything they do. And teacher would be crazy to just say, well, okay, I immediately like everything. Of course, they're going to be skeptical, and they're going to need to be shown how this is going to work with their particular children. One thing, for example, that's very difficult for teachers is that we expect an amazing amount of things to happen every single day. They say, we can never cover all of that. We'll never do all of those things. It's impossible. And the first times they try it, they can't. But it's a question of using time very effectively and being very efficient, using the responses of students to know what you need to spend time on and what you really don't need to spend time on, what the students already have. And so over time, you have teachers who were very skeptical at the outset being able to see, yeah, this is making a difference. But we know, and this is really quite important, we know that the schools we work in, which usually are very high poverty schools that have not achieved success in the past, they've tried everything. They've done so many things that have come and gone over the years. You have to show to them, you have to show real success very early. By Christmas, they have to be saying, I've never seen a class like this before in my life. They have to be saying, I know I can reach children I could not reach before. If they're not, then you're fighting a losing battle. So we have to move very quickly to try to get the most important parts of the program in place and to get them in place with very high quality as early as we can. It is. In many different ways, both in terms of seeing children that they didn't think they could reach that they can now reach, and seeing, you know, the levels of success and enthusiasm in children that they hadn't seen before. But another thing that is quite important to the people who experience it, but I think from the outside is often difficult to see, is that the teachers are working as a team across the whole school. And so they have the feeling of, we can do it. We working together can make this difference. That is not a common feeling for teachers. Most teachers go in their classroom, they close the door, and they do the best they can do. But this program is designed to try to build on a collaboration among all of the people in the school, and they really feel as though the success is not only just their personal success, but it's something that it's bigger than themselves, that they were participating in and feeling very proud about, as people do when they work in a collaborative group. Yes, well, we have for reading, for writing, also for mathematics. Our focus is on the topics that really constitute success. In American schools, probably in schools anywhere, reading is overwhelmingly the most important topic in the elementary grades. It's the only topic, for example, that is, you know, if you can't read, you may be sent to special education. You may be held back in school for a year. You may, you know, very bad things happen. If you can't do mathematics, they say, well, maybe you'll get it next year. But it's not a small thing, but it's not what really constitutes success in the same way. And that's really the reason that we focus so much on reading, is not only because it's so important as a skill in itself, but also because it really is the marker of success that every school understands. I sometimes joke that if drawing or singing were what that was defined as success, that's what we would focus on, and we would provide tutoring in drawing and singing. And I would have been in special education myself. But it's not completely a joke. It matters whether children see themselves as successful, whether their parents and their teachers see them as successful. They have to start off with a sense that they can master what the school asks of them, whatever that may be. Since it is reading, that's the critical skill, then of course that's where you have to start.
Could you, perhaps now is the time to show the book, and Elfie, of course.
So this, I'll introduce you here. This is Alfie.
Hi, Alfie.
Alfie is a puppet who will appear in any first grade class in any Success for All schools. At one time, we encouraged teachers to bring in their own Alfies, and this caused a lot of trouble. So we finally said, okay, everybody will have the same Alfie. Sort of a little bit like the approach in the whole program.
You had it designed.
Yes, we had it designed and made just for us. Teachers use Alfie, and it's wonderful to see, this is not unique to our program, wonderful to see the degree to which how children relate to puppets. Kids will even come up and whisper things to Alfie that they don't want the teacher to hear. The teacher's right here, but they'll whisper to Alfie, who they see as a living being, until you put him down. So Alfie, many teachers don't have Alfie speak. They have Alfie whisper to them. So they say, you know, Alfie, do you have anything you'd like to say to the children? And Alfie says, pss, 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 pss. Oh, Alfie says that he's very glad to see that you have all come to class on time today and are in your places and ready for another wonderful day of learning. So that they don't have to become actors or, you know, puppeteers. And Alfie will often help the children read. We designed a series of books. This is also for the kindergartners or first graders. And what these books do is introduce the sounds of English to the children in a step-by-step fashion. The books are designed to be interesting and, you know, they have a definite story. But they only use the sounds and letters that have been introduced and mastered by the children. So they, in a progressive way, children get more and more sounds that they can then use to read more and more complex stories. The children do a lot of reading back and forth to each other, and Alfie might demonstrate, you know, Alfie reads his page and then you read your page to get across to the children the key ideas that we're trying to communicate to them. We started the Best Evidence Encyclopedia when we had a grant from the U.S. Department of Education to try to introduce to whole school districts proven programs and practices. So the first thing we had to do is to find out what were the proven programs and practices. The grant ended, and we then had a substantial beginning on this Best Evidence Encyclopedia, which is intended to help busy administrators and teachers to find out what is the evidence that supports a given practice or a given program. The idea is that we try to organize it to make it where you can have as much information as you want. If you just want to know, is it good or is it not good? Then that information is there. If you then say, well, I want to know further, for whom is it good and under what circumstances and so on, you can look further into the Best Evidence Encyclopedia. Ultimately, there are whole articles, some of which, you know, in the most detailed versions can be 150 pages, that will review the research on secondary mathematics or on elementary reading or whatever it might be, that will explain what the individual studies were, what the findings were, and then try to find patterns about what kinds of things work and what kinds of things don't. So it's intended really to say, well, whatever your level of interest is, whatever you need to find out, here is where you can go to obtain this information. We have a version of this same Best Evidence Encyclopedia that we also have launched in the UK that has some different, you know, programs that exist in the UK and some, you know, the language and policy background of the UK that's somewhat different. There is U.S. Department of Education also has something called the What Works Clearinghouse that's trying to do something somewhat similar. And we are trying to find points of, you know, where we intersect and where we don't intersect with that effort as well. But it's very important. If you're if you're serious about evidence as a basis for educational educational advancement, then somebody has to be willing to say, well, what works, what doesn't? You couldn't have medicine and say, well, use effective medicines, but I won't tell you what they are. You know, somebody's got to be able to say, well, this has been tested and found to be effective. This has been tested and did not show a positive effect. And we're trying to do that in education as well. Well, it's easy in the sense it's conceptually easy. It's no different from what's done in medicine. You know, the methods for it are well established, but it's expensive and time consuming. People just can't. Even if they understand what should be done, they just can't do it with the amount of funding that's available to them. But basically, what you want to know is whether the new experimental program used with children, let's say over a year or longer than a year, produces better learning gain than the program they were using before. It's a simple comparison. Ideally, you would want schools or classrooms assigned at random to either get the new program or use the old program. And you would test them at the beginning and test them at the end. It's not so hard. But just saying that that's not so hard, that there are enormous difficulties in terms of making that simple design something that's practical in real schools.
Yeah, and then following the people over the years.
Well, if you're doing for many years, that's an additional complication. You also face the complication that schools and teachers don't like to be assigned at random. So you have to convince them that this is something that's worthwhile. And to provide some kind of reason for them to be willing to participate and whichever group they're assigned to. Well, they didn't do it just for us. What happened is that when President Obama came into office, as part of his Recovery Act, which was a stimulus funding to help the U.S. get out of the recession, one of the things that he funded was a program called Investing in Innovation, or I3. Now, I3 money was, which initially was $650 million, was dedicated to funding, providing a lot of funds to programs that had strong evidence of effectiveness already, somewhat less for programs that had, for example, a single study that showed them to be effective but needed more research, and then less than that for programs that needed to develop something, that had a good idea or had started on something but had not done any research on it at all. So the idea was to build up the whole pipeline of programs. So Success for All received one of four scale-up, which is the highest level, grants. So it wasn't just, convincing them about us. Once you are saying that there will be funding for programs that already have strong evidence of effectiveness, that can go to scale, that can work at a large scale, then Success for All is the first thing that comes to most people's minds if they know the area at all. So it wasn't surprising. We didn't have to make a special argument. We had to submit a proposal like anyone else, but it wasn't terribly surprising that it would be successful. What was amazing and had never happened before was government saying that evidence was going to be a criterion for success. That was what was amazing. It's not that they did it for us, they didn't, but that they did it for the country. They said, this is important for our education system and for our children, that the children receive proven programs and practices rather than continue the way things have always been. Well, there are about 100,000 U.S. schools, and about 1,000 use Success for All. So that's 1%. Now, if you look at high poverty elementary schools, There's a category of schools called Title I school-wide projects. That's about 33,000 schools. So that's more the group that we're, you know, trying to influence. But it's still a small proportion of all schools. But it provides a model that hopefully others will try to achieve as well. And that's part of the purpose of I3, is to bring along other approaches that may be quite different that will do things like what Success for All does.
Is this also kind of a dream for you to pursue in the next 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years?
Right. It is. I would not be satisfied if lots and lots of schools were just using Success for All. This has to become normal, that there are many people, many different groups, that are trying to create more and more effective programs and practices to use with schools, especially with schools serving disadvantaged children. And so to me, that really would be critical in the next many years, that there were a system that encouraged people to come up with a wide range of different kinds of approaches that have in common only that they work, that they actually make a difference with children.
The outcome is okay.
The outcome has to be there, but once you've proven the outcome, then, you know, whatever you're doing, go for it. We have been constantly tinkering with Success for All from the very beginning. In recent years, as you might imagine, we've incorporated a great deal of technology. And so, you know, where it had no technology when it began, there's use of interactive whiteboards, of technology for assessing children. We use technology to assist tutors working one-to-one or in small groups with children who are struggling. And we're doing a lot more with the use of technology for the professional development inside the school and many other things. As technology develops, then it provides more and more opportunities to accomplish things that we've been trying to accomplish without technology, but that we now can do better, we hope, using the technology. Standards change. In the U.S. now, there's Common Core state standards that most of the states are adopting, and that changes the content, and we have to change that. It's always a process of change and redevelopment, but the basic concepts are very much the same as what we started with in 1987. How do you make sure that every child is going to learn to read? How do you, what are the methods, the strategies, materials that are necessary to see that every single child is going to be successful? Well, there was a study that just came out that was looking at children who had started in the program in third grade. The program is really designed to try to have children who are starting in kindergarten or first grade to make sure that they don't start falling behind. So in a way, we hope and have other evidence that says it is good for children who start in third grade, but it's not the most essential question for us, because the most essential question has to do with what happens to children if they start this way and then never are allowed to fall behind from the beginning. But still, it's, if you believe in research, you have to believe in all of the research. And, we take that finding seriously, and it makes us look that much harder at our upper elementary program. The basic principles should work just as well in the Netherlands. We are having some conversations, as you may know, at Groningen about this very...
Roel Bosker told me.
That's
yeah,
right.
Yeah.
About this very idea. And it's just a question of resources, really. There is work to be done, but it's straightforward work. you know, the program has to be redeveloped for the Dutch language and for the Dutch culture and the culture of, you know, the education system. So that's a big job. But it's not an endlessly big job. And when you think about the amount that we spend on children in school, doing a reform of this kind is so inexpensive. But nobody perceives it that way. I mean, an average child in the U.S. gets, an average child, we spend about $10,000 per year on that child. Success for All costs about $120 per year per child in the first 3 years, and then it drops down to about $60 after that. That's nothing, nothing. You know, in the grand scheme of things, it's absolutely nothing. And I'm sure that if you used numbers from the Netherlands, it would be just the same. It simply makes no sense to me why liberal societies like the Netherlands and the U.S. that care deeply about children and care deeply about their education, who know how much the education of their children is going to determine their place in the world in the future, have difficulty with the resources necessary to make that tiny little additional investment that makes all the difference. And yet, you know, I'm certain we're going to find it difficult in the Netherlands, as we have in the U.S. and in the U.K., to make that point, to make the case that it's worthwhile spending a few hundred dollars per child for the early years of a child's experience to make sure that they really do succeed, using strategies that are very well established, that are very, you know, much proven, not just in our own research, but in many others as well, and that every teacher should be able to use.
It can be done. It must be done.
It's just no question that it could be done, and it's only a question of political will to see that it is. I don't know why this is so hard. It's, you know, I'm happy to do it. There are often wonderful people who care deeply about children, but it's just endlessly frustrating. There's always some reason that it's just that now is not the right time, or that this is not the, you know, we can't get the political will or whatever. And when you see all of the things that they are willing to spend money on or to focus on, even in education, much less in all the other crazy things they do, it's just always amazing to me how, you know, why is it so hard when you meet these people and they are intelligent, good people, want good things for kids. I don't know why this necessarily has to be so hard.
Do you spend a lot of time doing that?
I do, and particularly dealing with this issue of evidence-based reform that's beyond Success for All specifically, trying to establish the idea that that evidence should be a basis for policy making in education. Again, who's going to argue the opposite? Who's going to stand up and say, no, I believe in ignorance? We should, you know, but nevertheless, that's what really does happen, is that ignorance always prevails. And I don't know how long it's going to take of, you know, keep continuing to, you know, hit my head against that wall and have others who do as well, before somebody will finally say, well, we've tried ignorance, we've done that, you know, that long enough, maybe we should try something different this time. But it's just endlessly difficult. No, I try not to do that. You know, it's very but it's intimidating, you know, to have the boss do it. So I try not to do that. But for me, it's I get the same pleasure. I get greater pleasure when I see a teacher where you can see that this teacher was not going to be particularly outstanding or brilliant all by themselves, but they've gotten a hold of something that they can do, and they're seeing wonderful outcomes for their children. That's what has to change. I think that sometimes people have gone wrong because they have in their own minds, in their own experience, a sense about the fantastic, amazing, superhero teacher who can take the most difficult children and turn them around and get them to be successful. That's what they remember, that's what they were, and so they just imagine, well, if you only had 10,000 teachers like me, then all would be well. Where are these 10,000 teachers, or these 100,000 teachers, or these million teachers? They're, you know, teachers are, I love teachers, and I, you know, I have the in most greatest respect for them, but there's not a million of them just waiting somewhere for us to call them to come in and solve all of our problems. The teachers that we have in our schools now are a lot like the teachers we're going to have in our schools in 5 years or 10 years or 20 years or whenever. What we need is a better place for them to work, better methods for them to use, better tools, better puppets, better technology for them to use to take the enormous energy and the enormous intelligence that they bring to the school and translate that into success for children. 50 years is a long way to look into the future, but I am optimistic, against all evidence, that this this movement toward evidence will prevail. It's prevailed in medicine, it prevailed in engineering, it prevailed in agriculture. Why shouldn't it work in education? There's simply no reason. And I think that over the years, the whole process will change by which you become a teacher, and definition of what you do inside a school will change, where people will be looking at you know, what are the best ways to accomplish all of the tasks that have to be accomplished in every school, you know, to organize your lessons, present them to children, to assess children, to manage classrooms, to you know, all of, to deal with children who are far below the pace, to deal with children who are far above the pace, who are very capable. All of these things, we should be using the practices that are well established in evidence, and I think that that's coming slowly, but it's coming. And I would be astonished if 10 years from now we weren't much further down that road. There are many developments. The I3 that I mentioned earlier, the EEF in the UK, which is the Education Endowment Fund, that's foundation that's also doing things like I3, the work that's starting in Groningen, there and a lot of discussion in other places as well, that I think is making it so that it is difficult to just say that we're doing well enough. One of the things that made it possible for Martin Luther King to succeed is that everybody knew that segregation was wrong. I mean, there were some people who were from the cave days and still believed in it, and there were, you know, and racists and so on. But the vast majority of Americans understood that this was wrong, but it didn't affect them in their daily life, and it had always been that way, and it was easy to let it stay. And the lack of doing something proactive to end it was what kept it possible for it to continue for a very long time. Even though if you took a poll, you know, 80% of Americans would have said this is wrong and has to stop right now. I am hoping that the situation with evidence will be like that. It's not that anybody opposes it. It's that nobody stands up and says this is wrong and we must do something about it right now. Because as soon as somebody stands up and says that and it becomes widely heard, then who is going to stand in their way? You know, who is going to say this is wrong and has to be stopped, this evidence thing? It could be done in the wrong way, and, you know, there's many ways it could go wrong. But I just think that the failure of schools to embrace evidence, as medicine did, as agriculture did, as many other fields did, is not really an opposition. It's just a lack of a vision of what this could be for schools. And as that vision comes, I think that there will be real change. And I desperately hope I'm right. And I would have said the same thing 10 years ago, and I would have been wrong. But at least we're showing some progress. 400 years, you should have gotten it right by now.
Well, that's a nice one. Well, thank you very much for this interview. I really enjoyed it. Yeah.
Okay.